Greetings once again from Greece. Well, it has been much too long since we last communicated, and since I last sent you a postcard from Greece. And I'm once again in the unfortunate position of asking your forgiveness. But so that we not lose much time, let me get right to the subject matter at hand today in this postcard. First of all, I want to wish you a blessed Christmas season and that you finish the feast, which is a 12-day feast, with joy and happiness. And I hope that the following might help in that, in helping you spiritually to celebrate the feast spiritually, joyfully, in an Orthodox manner. Throughout the world, everyone who is trying to struggle to live an Orthodox life understands how difficult things are becoming, and in particular, what one observes is the threat at hand for the Orthodox themselves to lose the savor of Orthodoxy, the otherworldly feeling and experience that sets the Orthodox Christian and the life of the Orthodox Church apart from everything else in the world, which takes the Christian out of the fallenness of this world and rejuvenates him with the Spirit of God. It is this savor of Orthodoxy, this living experience of the grace of God, which one must struggle very hard today to obtain, preserve, and increase in their spiritual life. It is perhaps the most imminent and greatest threat to each of us if we are to remain true Orthodox Christians and not simply maintain the dogmas in a cold, rational way. And for many of us who've become Orthodox in later in life, truly, this is a challenge because we have the baggage of many years outside of the life of the Church, the life of the grace of the Holy Spirit that the Church offers. And we have obtained an intellectual knowledge, and many of us perhaps even think that we've arrived with this intellectual knowledge, this understanding of the gospel, the history of the Church, of the errors of other groups which had not been connected to the historic Church, the experience of the Church for 2,000 years now. And so we mistakenly believe that we've arrived and we've become good Orthodox Christians, understand and live the faith because we understand intellectually, logically, rationally those issues, those many issues of dogma and history. But in fact, we're just beginning. We're just beginning to understand the Orthodox Church. If one does not enter into the life of the Church and go deep and deeper every day into the spirit and the humility that is a part of the Orthodox Christian life, that is, it's incumbent upon us to obtain and experience and understand. If one does not grow spiritually into the stature of Christ and obtain a level of discernment and all the other virtues and things that come with the attainment of the grace of God, the preservation of the grace of God, well then, they're not making progress. We're not making progress. We're not really Orthodox Christians in the fullest sense of the word. We're not experiencing the Orthodox Christian life. So having that in mind, having this need to go deeper and acquire the grace of God in ever-increasing quantities and making progress in the acquisition of the virtues and especially the taste of the savor of Orthodoxy, having this in mind, as I sat and thought, what could I do to assist you all in this struggle? And how this might tie into the whole feast of Christmas. Well, when I think of something that exists here in Greece that many people do not have access to outside of Greece and that I might be able to convey and bring to their knowledge, I think of oftentimes Photios Kontoglou, one of the greatest iconographers in Greece in the 20th century, but also very noteworthy, his writings. His writings were very exceptional in conveying the savor of Orthodoxy, which is the theme here we're talking about today. So I decided that I would translate a small text that is in one of his books, and he writes about the holy days of Christmas. And I'm just going to read a portion of it, And I hope that this will help you in better understanding and celebrating both the Feast of Christmas and also the whole savor of Orthodoxy. So here is the text of Photios Kontoglou, the Holy Days of Christmas, part of the text. And let's follow carefully what this exceptional Orthodox Christian of the 20th century has to say to us, the poor Christians of the last times. Only an Orthodox Christian celebrates the Feast of the Nativity in a spiritual, truly spiritual manner. And through his soul do pass spiritual feelings, which warm it with a certain strange fervor, which comes from another world, the warmth of the Holy Spirit, according to the hymn of ascent, which is sung in every matins. In the Holy Spirit every soul is quickened, and through cleansing is exalted and made radiant by the triple unity in a hidden sacred manner. Soul and body celebrate together, rejoicing with divine light, which is not tasted by those who are found far from Christ. During these holy days, the heart of the Christian is filled with the aroma of hymnody, filled with a most sweet outpouring of spiritual light, which covers all of creation, the mountains, the sea, every rock, every tree, every stone, every created thing. All is holy, all exultant, all a chorus, all rejoicing. All of nature is as a fruitful olive tree in the house of the Lord. No one can feel such joy in his heart save he alone who loves God and lives the days of his life with God. For no one save God alone can give such joy, such peace, as the Lord himself said during the mystical supper. My peace I give unto you, not as the world giveth, give I unto you. The joy and peace of Christ is distinct from the joy and peace of this world. That is why the man who rejoices in going to church and in drinking of this immortal spring of true joy and peace says together with David, Send out, O Lord, thy light and thy truth. They have guided me along the way and have brought me unto thy holy mountain and unto thy tabernacles. And I shall go in unto the altar of the Lord, unto God who giveth gladness to my youth. Let us therefore also, brethren, celebrate the nativity of Christ in spirit and truth, in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. And then all else shall be added unto us, the joy of the home, the joy of the family, nature, good company, wholesome entertainment, for all will be sweetened with the love of Christ and made warm by the ardor of him who is the life-giver. The birth of Christ is for us a great lesson in humility. Where was he born? Within a manger, or more accurately, a feed trough. So that we might more deeply feel the unspeakable condescension of God. For the ancient words make even the poorest things to appear rich in our eyes. His mother, the most holy Theotokos, far from her home, a stranger in a strange land, came and gave birth to him in a sheepfold. The ox and the donkey warmed him with their breathing. Shepherds kept him company. The Lamb of God, who came into the world to save man from the curse of Adam, was reckoned to dwell among the newborn lambs. What man was born in greater humility? St. Isaac the Syrian writes in his Discourse on Humility the following wonderful words. I want to open my mouth, my brethren, and speak of the exalted subject of humility, but I am full of fear, like the man who knows that he is about to speak of God. For humility is the robe of divinity. The Word of God, which became man, was clothed in humility and came into contact with us with humility, assuming a body like our own. Whoever has been clothed in humility has truly become like him who descended from his great height, who covered the virtue of his majesty and glory with humility, such that we, upon seeing that he is one of our race and speaks as a man, would not be overcome with fear by the sight of his appearance. So it is, then, that whoever is clothed with the robe which the Lord wore, that is, humility, has put on Christ himself. The manger is the humble heart, my brethren, and only within such a heart does Christ go to be born. The church is radiant within the wintry gloom as she celebrates the birth of the Lord. Within her is heard an otherworldly hymnody, like that which the angels sung. This is a text from Photios Kontoglou, written about 60 years ago, which is a timeless text in my estimation, for he entered into the timeless experience of the feast of the church, the grace of the God which one experiences in the humility which the God-man communicates to those who love him. In a word, then, we might say that the savor of orthodoxy is this otherworldly experience of the humility of Christ. That it is humility, it is the robe of divinity, it is the basis, the stuff of being an Orthodox Christian. That it permeates everything in the church. And that without this humility, without this otherworldly savor of the grace of God, an experience of the grace of God, one cannot be an Orthodox Christian. I pray for you, and I hope you will pray for me, that in spite of the immense pressure from the world today, in spite of the great pride that is foisted upon every soul in this world through so many means, through the television, through the radio, through the advertisements, through all the thoughts that fill the minds of so many millions of people who have made it their life's goal to obtain riches, fame, and all the other vain things of this world, and therefore are filled not with the savor of orthodoxy and humility, but with the opposite. All of this fallenness, all of this world that is running after vanity and is caught up in the nets of the evil one, I pray, and I hope you will pray for me too, that we might avoid that. We might take refuge in the Church of God, take refuge in the truth of the gospel, and take refuge most of all in the humility of the Word of God and the life of the church, far away from the logic of this world, which is bent upon the destruction of man's spiritual life, far away from the vain conceit and ideas of contemporary man, in indifference, in fact, to all of it, we might run after the pearl of great price, calculating nothing except the attainment and sacrificing all for the attainment of this pearl, which is the faith, which is the experience of the grace of God. Until we speak again, which I hope will be much sooner than the last time, until we speak again, may God be with you.